Hey, Grace City, so glad to be with you on this online experience. We've got a lot of things coming up for you. We're gonna have some opportunity to worship together. We'll be in a series and hearing from one of our pastors, and then you'll be able to grab maybe your favorite beverage or whatever will allow you to get into a worshipful posture. In the meantime, why don't you go ahead and check us out at wearegrace.city so that you can learn more about our church and next steps that you can take here as well. And so go ahead and get ready. We're about to start worship.
Do you see what I see? But it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures of faith are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws, Lord.
Seas into highways. You're the only one who
his hands, his feet, my Savior, that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah stood and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore, for endless days.
Well, good morning, Grace City. You may be seated. Good morning, good morning, and happy Easter, y'all. So glad that you came and you are early. Thank you for creating space at our other services for newcomers and new friends. Hey, we are so excited for this day and the many things that are coming up. Matter of fact, if you are here for the first time, welcome. Thank you for taking the risk at being with us today. You can fill out a Connect card. It would be found in your worship guide today. And if you fill that out at any time during the service, you'll have an opportunity to hand that in and we can get to know you better. But before I go any further, I need to introduce to you all the Bunny Squad. The Bunny Squad. This is our first trip around this today, so thank you for bearing with us. This is our Bunny Squad, everybody. Earlier this time, there we go. So they had an opportunity to share with the kiddos some gifts. If there's someone in here today that has not been given a gift, we'd like to give you one from the Bunny Squad. They have candy. We asked them not to go towards the face. And so if one happens to get near your face, we apologize in advance. All right. Awesome. Hey, so there's some awesome things going on this week, too. Matter of fact, Late Cares, our mobile food pantry, will be here Wednesday. And so if you're looking for a way to get connected, haven't had an opportunity to serve at Grace City yet, you can come that day. It's really cool, really awesome. We get an opportunity to partner with Late Cares and feed people that may be in need and get to pray and build relationships with them too. So you can show up at 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. and we'll train you on the fly and we'll have a great time. Hey, if you've been with us the last couple weeks and you've been all in with Build Your Church Initiative and you committed last week, thank you so much. We're so excited for what God is doing. We're going to be celebrating and sharing the total commitments this upcoming Sunday and celebrating through our spring fling. And so you have an opportunity hear what's going on, plus get to hang out and be part of a mac and cheese contest. If you'd like to sign up for that and get your best recipe in, you can get in before this weekend. Just fill out a connection card. But we will have free barbecue, bounce houses for the kids and the adults, and baptisms. And so if you'd like to take that next step with us, you can fill that out on the connect card or sign up online as well. But hey, in the meantime, would you mind standing with us and just greeting your neighbor this Easter morning with a hug? Hug or high five.
Hey, Grace City family. Man, it is so good to be with you this morning. For centuries, on Easter Sunday morning, on Resurrection Sunday morning, as believers have gathered together, they have greeted each other by saying, "He is risen. He is risen indeed. He is risen indeed." I want to take you back right away. I just want to jump right into it, to that very first Easter Sunday morning, that very first Resurrection Sunday morning. And I love the account in Mark 16. It says this, I'm going to just jump right in. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they may go over to anoint Jesus' body. Now, I just got to point this out for just a second. I know it's early, but I would be remiss if I didn't say I love this verse for so many reasons. I'm trying to picture this, like the first time Mark sharing this with somebody, right? Like, hey, so this these ladies went over to go to the tomb, and who was there? Oh, well, there was this lady, and her name was Mary. And who else was there? Another lady, and her name was Mary. No, you already said, Mary. Yeah, but you already said Mary. Yeah, Mary. Like, hey, that could be a musical. Like Mary, okay. And then there was a third lady, and she went over. Oh, what was her name, Mary? No, why would you think that? Well, what was her name? Salami. Like, can you, I'm trying to picture him. Like, to me, the beginning of this just sounds a bit too much like a Mad Lib I would have written about the East, like, right? Like, it just gives me that vibe. The second thing I just love about this is, what are they bringing over? Spices. The first visitors to the empty tomb were the Spice Girls. Like, the original Spice Girls, Mary, and Salami. And so I just love this. Now, I'm making light of it, but pause for a second and just think about this. Like, I was trying to wrap my head around that. Like, every year, Good Friday and Easter, I'm walking into this this weekend, and we dressed upright, and there's Easter eggs and parties and things all over town, and people come. That's beautiful. Can we remember just for a second how, like, what happened on Good Friday? What Saturday must have felt like? And even where they're feeling Sunday morning on their way in, like, we have Easter eggs, right? But if you were doing an Easter egg depiction of what's going on here, it'd look a little something like this. I mean, it's, right? I didn't want it graphic for the kids who will be at later services because they slept in past the 8 o'clock service, but right? But this is like a hopeless situation. They've already given up. The disciples are on the run. Jesus, who they had followed, crucified, buried, but all the, I don't know, well, let's take some spices and we'll go over and to anoint his dead body. And that's how it starts out. But listen, this is so amazing. So this Spice Girls, Mary, and Salami, you remember them? They head over, verse 2, very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb. Verse 3, and they asked each other, who will roll away the stone from the entrance of the tomb? I love this because, like, we probably should have thought of this. We'll figure it out on the way. I resonate with that. Verse 4, but when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. I'm a word freak. I'm always curious as to the word behind the word. Our earliest copies of this are in Greek, and the word there translated alarm, it's ekthumbeo. Here's the definition of it. Here's what it means. It's not like, oh wow, I'm alarmed. It means this, properly out of one's senses with the outcome of being amazed to the level of wonder, to be struck with amazement or terror. If there was a picture to describe ekthumbeo, it would be this. Like, that's, because when you're expecting to go see a dead body buried, this is, what? And what does he say? Verse 6, don't be ekthumbeo, don't be out of here. It's okay, don't be alarmed, he said. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. Can we just read that together? He has risen. He is not here. I love this. See the place where they laid him. Go, take a look. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee, and there you will see him just as he told you. Like, guys, he told you this. And did you forget? He told you this. It's amazing. Risen, he is risen indeed. And I love that little, just that little sense. They're like, oh, go ahead and take a look. Come on in, see for yourself. He's risen indeed. Come on, take a look. Take a look. It's amazing because when you read through both the historical account and the New Testament, this is what happened. This is what I love the way Paul says it in 1 Corinthians 15. All right, the Apostle Paul is talking about the resurrection. He says, now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel, you're saved. This is the gospel. If you hold firmly to the word I preached to you, otherwise you believe in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, most important. Here's what's the most important thing, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, Good Friday, and that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. And he appeared to Peter, and then he appeared to the 12. After that, there was that time he appeared to 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time. Like, who actually saw him? Well, there was that time there's 500 of us that all saw him. Most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Paul's writing this shortly after the resurrection. He's like, hey, just go ask. Like, there were 500 of us there that saw him that time. I mean, some of us had breakfast with him by the beach. He made some fish sandwiches for breakfast. I mean, he appeared to Peter, appeared to me. Yeah. Go ask them. Then he appeared to James. Then he appeared to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me also. The resurrection is factual. It's historical. It's like, Paul's like, yeah, just go check it out. I ask anybody, go check. The tomb's empty. Or the angels are like, look, the tomb's empty. Come and see for yourself. Paul's like, hey, he's risen. There were all these witnesses. Go check him out. The same guys that were on the run are now willing to die for it. Like no, this, it happened. Thomas Arnold, not to be confused with Tom Arnold, the comedian, Thomas Arnold was the chair of modern history at Oxford University. He says this, I know of no one fact in the history of mankind which is proved by better and fuller evidence of every sort than the great sign which God hath given us that Christ died and rose again from the dead. The chair of modern history at Oxford said, look, there's nothing that has more evidence than that in all history. Like, that, there's just so much evidence there. Jesus' resurrection, it's historical, it's fact, it is factual. In fact, if you ask, a survey was done a couple years ago among Americans, and here's what it found. 86% of Americans believe in a historical Jesus. And that's a lot, isn't it? 77% of Americans believe he rose from the dead. They called him up, they did a poll. Hey, do you believe Jesus was his? Yep. Okay, do you believe he rose from the dead? Yep. 77%. I mean, that's actually really a lot if you think about it. Because you're like, well, it's not 100%. I just want to fill in some gaps. Just for perspective, 11% of people like now still think that Elvis may still be alive. More than that believe that the lunar landing was fake. Hundreds of people gathered in November last year thinking JFK Jr. was going to announce a run for office. And a 2018 survey found that 1/3 of millennials believe the earth is flat. I question the last one, but should I? So just for perspective, and I realize I just read those, I probably offended somebody because statistically somebody in the room's like, yeah, the earth is flat. I knew the lunar landing was fake, and we love you, and we are so glad you're with us this morning. In the name of Jesus. I mean, the question really isn't whether or not it's factual or historical. Most people actually believe that. And here's my guess. If you're in the room right now, you're like, yeah, he's risen indeed. Sure. If I was going through and I was filling out the bubbles, I'd be like, survey says, yep. That's not the issue, is it? The issue is not whether or not it's historical, not whether it's factual. Here's the real issue is it personal? How has it affected you? How has the resurrection of Jesus actually affected you? I love what Paul says. In 1 Corinthians 15, we just read, he's like, he appeared here, he appeared there, he appeared to the 500 of us, he showed up at breakfast that time, he was with all the apostles, and this last one right here, he says, and last of all, he appeared to me also. In the next couple of verses after that, he's like, and you don't understand, I'm the least of the apostles, like me, but man, it made all the difference in my life. And I love that invitation. It's the same invitation. I want to give you the same invitation this morning that the angel did on that first Easter morning. Come and see for yourself. And just take a look at Jesus and how has his resurrection affected you? Maybe this morning you are the skeptic. Let me just circle back there for a moment. Maybe this morning you're the skeptic. You're like, I've got questions. And can I just tell you, you're in good company. You are. You're in good company. Questions are okay. One of Jesus' early disciples, this guy named Thomas, earned the nickname Doubting Thomas. He's the one like, Jesus resurrected, and they're telling Thomas, and he's like, yeah, I'm not really buying it. I'm having a hard time buying it. I mean, and think about this. Like, we're so used to that part of the story for some of us. We've heard this a lot, but think about it. He has seen Jesus walk on water, heal people, give sight to the blind. Like, he had seen that one time where he took another fish sandwich, a couple of them, from McDonald's and fed 5,000 people. It wasn't from McDonald's, I know, but it just makes me happy to think that. Thomas had seen all that. But he's like, yeah, I'm just really having a hard time wrapping my mind and my heart around it. But I love the way Jesus responds to him. John 20:27, it says, he said to Thomas, hey, Thomas, you got doubts? Come here, put your finger here. See in my hands? Reach out, put your hands in my side. Come on, take a look. I love that. I mean, he made it like Thomas is like, guys, Jesus is right there. Yeah, we know, we told you. Like, he's right there. Yeah, we know. He told, hey, Thomas, come on over here. Heard you had some doubts. Why don't you stick your hand in here? Right? I think Jesus has a great sense of humor. Here's what I love about that, though, is that Jesus, the seeker, finds safety. It's okay to ask questions. It's okay to wrestle. I never find a place where somebody comes to Jesus with a sincere curiosity, question, doubt, and vulnerable, and just like, Jesus, I've got my doubts. Jesus, I'm still asking questions. And Jesus turns them away angry. It's rather, he's always compassionate in that place. Like, come on, bring your questions to me. One of my favorite prayers, Mark 29:24. This guy is talking, and Jesus is like, hey, everything is possible for those that believe. And he responds, and I've prayed this prayer as much as any prayer in my life. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. He says this to Jesus in desperation, like, I believe, but help those areas where I still don't believe. That gives me so much comfort. Because here's the thing, a seeker will ultimately find not just safety, but will eventually find satisfaction. That all those questions, all those doubts, Jesus is like, bring him here. I can handle him. It's safe here. And they'll eventually find satisfaction. Or what about this other guy, Peter? Peter the failure. If he had a nickname, it'd be the failure. And I know what it's like to feel like a failure. And not just on the little things. I shared with our students recently. I once struck out in slow pitch softball with a bunch of elementary kids as an adult. Right? This little fourth grader behind me was talking trash and totally psyched me out. And when he said swing batter, swing, I swung. I struck out. But when I look at my life, I've struck out way bigger than that. The stuff that I don't want to tell you about because I'm embarrassed. Right? Peter the failure. Peter is one of the guys, as much as any mess up, he's like, Jesus, I'm going to follow you anywhere. But when push came to shove, he denied Jesus 3 times. I don't even know him. Curses him. That's why I love that little detail in Mark 16 that we were reading. And the angel says, yeah, come see for yourself. Go and tell the disciples. Mark 16:7. Can we throw this up here? I want you to see this. Go and tell the disciples. Next slide. Go and tell the disciples. He is going ahead of you into Galilee. Oh, go and tell the disciples. And what's the next 2 words? And Peter. I love Jesus' compassion right there. Hey, go and tell the disciples and make sure you grab Peter. Go tell Peter. He's risen. Go and tell the disciples, don't forget Peter, because he's the one that's really hurting right now. He's the one that's blown it. He's the one that messed up. He's the one that skipped. Go and tell the disciples and Peter. Here's the thing with Jesus, the failure finds forgiveness. The failure finds forgiveness. But even better, if you know any of Peter's story in the Bible, this isn't the end of Peter's story. Jesus restores him, and then Jesus uses Peter to build his church and to spread the good news. See, the failure not only finds forgiveness, but even more than that, the failure finds a fresh start. He's restored completely. Or maybe this morning, maybe one that you'd resonate with is Mary the Heartbroken, if I had a nickname for her. Mary, John 20, verse 15 records it this way. It says Jesus, Mary is there in the garden around the tomb, and she's just sobbing because her heart's completely broken. Dear woman, Jesus says, why are you crying? Jesus asked her, but she can't see or hear past her own tears. Who are you looking for? She thought he was the gardener. Mary, Jesus said. She turned to him and cried out, Rabbi. She recognizes in that moment. See, with Jesus, the hurting find hope. The hurting find hope, and the hurting find healing. That's what you find with Jesus. That's what you find with Jesus. This morning, the very first text message I got this morning, the one that woke me up, I was afraid. I'm like, am I going to wake up on time? Okay, set the alarm, set the backup alarm. I have a feeling that the backup alarm of my children aren't going to work either. It's just because today I'm like, okay, I got to make sure they're all set. But you know what woke me up? It was a text message letting me know that my friend Linda had passed away. I saw Linda on Good Friday and said goodbye. Prayed with her. And it's actually kind of funny. The hospice nurse said she has maybe 7 or 10 days left. And her daughter, Holly, said, oh, I hope not. I hope not. She's ready. And I said, oh, I know. She's been ready for a long time. She's ready. And I just looked at Holly, and I'm like, I have a sneaky feeling Linda's going to pull a hat trick and go meet Jesus on Easter Sunday morning. Like, she's just going to hit it out of the park. Like, she's timing it, isn't she? There's something so beautiful. My last several conversations, she's just like, man, you know, I'm looking forward to it. I'm going to close my eyes, and one of these times, I'm going to open them and see Jesus. I know it's close. Linda, from her deathbed, with hospice in and out, with me coming to say goodbye, with family and surrounding her and holding her hand and reading scripture, hilariously, probably shouldn't share this, but last week she's like, hey, you need some of this communion wine. Hey, John, get him some wine. I'm like, I'm good, Linda. It's like 2 p.m. I'm good. She's like, no, you got to have some of this wine. John, get him some wine. I'm like, Linda, I'm good. I had some wine. We shared communion. But we were talking, and she's like, hey, I have this friend that I really want to get connected to church. And so you'll probably be seeing her. She lives, she's moving in here, and then the hospice nurse is in the hallway like, is she trying to send you new parishioners? And Linda just smiles and says, you know, you'd be amazed at what I can get done from this bed. Like, she's just still telling people about the hope she has in Jesus right up to that moment. C.H. McIntosh says this, there is power in the presence of a risen Savior to solve our difficulties, to remove our perplexities, calm our fears, ease our burdens, dry our tears, meet our every need, and satisfy every craving of our hearts. That's what the resurrection does. Yeah, you might believe in the resurrection, check it off, fill in the bubble, but how has it affected you? See, for Linda, her whole life was wrapped up in it. Her eternity was wrapped up in it. Her entire existence. I love what Philip Yancey says. This is one of my favorites. He says, I've weighed the arguments in favor of the resurrection, and they are indeed impressive. Yet I also know that many intelligent people have looked at the same evidence and found it impossible to believe. So what then gives me Easter faith? He says, I believe in the resurrection primarily because I've gotten to know God. I know that God is love, And I also believe this. If I did not believe this, I would not believe in a loving God, that God will not let death win. Jesus gives hope and healing for the heartbroken. This Easter Sunday morning has impacted me a different way because there's a lot of friends that I said goodbye to in the last year. But it's not a goodbye permanent. It's a see you soon. They just got a head start. Hope and healing. So I would ask again, what about you? Is his resurrection personal for you? How has it affected you? Paul, I told you in 1 Corinthians 15, he's like, he appeared to all these and he appeared to me too. And then he goes on the next couple of verses. He's like, man, I'm the least of the apostles. I can't believe that Jesus would show himself to me, that I would get to know Jesus. And then says this, but by verse 10, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And I love this line. It hit me yesterday. I'm like, I got to go back and read this. He says, and his grace to me was not without effect. It wasn't wasted at all. His grace towards me, it changed everything. It was not without effect. It affected me big time. How has the resurrection affected you? What effect has it had on you? I'll close with this, and then the team is going to come on up in just a moment. I was sitting by the pool yesterday with my kids, trying to sneak some time, with my kiddos before this weekend, before this morning. And I was watching the kids play in the water. It reminded me of something I shared with some friends a while back. And it got me thinking about all these different ways that the resurrection of Jesus affected people. And I saw this quote a couple years ago. I went back and I looked it back up last night. I was like, hey guys, you know how the slide's rolling? Can I add one? It's from Paula Gamble Grant. She says this, it's almost as if the apologetic of Christ's risenness becomes like a child's water wings, put on in order to keep us afloat, when really the fact that Jesus is risen means that we can walk on water. Like, I got to thinking, how has Jesus affected me? How much of my life has been wasted? I shared this with some friends a while back, but I'm like, man, I'm gonna share it again this morning. How much of my life? This thing's a little tight. Has been really just like, all right, here we go. It looks ridiculous. And at times my life has looked ridiculous. Like, do you believe in the resurrection? Like, well, I'm just going through life. I'm just kind of sitting here like, all right, we're just floating along through life. And like just this image always cracks me up, this idea of like clearly it's meant to be more than that, right? Like his resurrection is not just a means to keep me from drowning. But Jesus in his resurrection, in his grace, is the ocean we're supposed to be swimming in. I'm watching my kids do backflips into the water and climb under the waterfall and going down underneath and tackling each other and just playing and having so much fun. And I'm like, man, like that's it right there. Going through life. I was thinking of the old Irish pastor, Pete Rollins once said, this guy came up and was asking him like, yeah, I heard you preach and everything, but I didn't hear you talk about the resurrection. Do you deny the resurrection? And Pete turned to him and said, oh, absolutely, every day. I deny the resurrection every day. Every time I ignore the cries of the poor, every time I ignore someone who's hurting, I deny the resurrection. Every time I choose to store up treasures here instead of treasures there, I deny the resurrection. Every time I let little things come between me and others, instead of being bonded together, every time I waste a moment instead of making the most of every opportunity, I deny the resurrection. But he said, but sometimes there are moments, fleeting though they may be, where I affirm the resurrection, where I live it out. When I use my voice to stick up for others, when I give because it's been given to me, when I love my enemies the way Jesus loves me, he's like, there are times when I affirm the resurrection. And I'm gonna keep trying to do that. Paul, same guy, says in Philippians 3:10, I want to know Christ in the power of his resurrection. Like, I was trying to think through, like, if Paul was here listening to so many of the things that in my life, I'm just gonna say my life, my normal, I could say, here's all the things that I'm worried about and I'm afraid, and I could see Paul like, man, those are real. Absolutely. And you're allowed to feel those things. But can I just remind you, the tomb's empty, he rose. All the things I get mad at or angry about, I could just hear Paul like, yeah, I mean, I could see, that's very understandable. You know he's risen, right? The things that I get so obsessed with as far as my, like I'm really, 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 really excited, overwhelmingly excited to go see this movie, which is a true story. But I can see Paul being like, man, that's great. I bet it has great effects and all that. You know he's risen, right? Just drenched in the grace of God. And I just want to ask one more time, what has the resurrection of Jesus meant to you? Sure, it's historical, it's factual. Everybody in this room when we came in probably would have said, yeah, he's risen indeed. But you believe it. It's your life wrapped up in it. Because Paul says, no, for me, it was not without effect. It changed everything. It changed everything. He is risen. He is risen indeed. And I want to know him in the power of his resurrection. Team's going to close this in another song of worship, and we're going to celebrate because the tomb is empty. He is risen, and he gives us new life as well. And just maybe this morning, maybe if you're being honest with yourself, today's the day that you're like, yeah, no, that hasn't been the central part of my story. I might have circled the bubble, but Jesus hasn't had my life. I haven't really trusted him with my life or my forever. Can I just tell you, what better day? I was like, what better day for Linda to go and open her eyes and see Jesus than Easter? What better day for you to put your faith and trust in Jesus than today? So I want to give you a moment. If you can just bow your heads and close your eyes wherever you're at, and forget everybody else in the room for a second, just between you and God, and just that real question, one of the scariest verses to me, the saddest verses in all of Scripture, is Jesus saying at the end of time, people are going to be like, Jesus, and he's like, I'm sorry, I never knew you. Do you know Jesus? Do you know him? I want to give you an opportunity. Maybe today you're saying, I'm putting my faith and trust in Jesus. Good Friday, Easter, I'm getting it now. It all makes sense to me. And I want to give you an opportunity to respond. And you can do it right where you're at. And if you need, like, okay, what do I do? What do I say? You don't do anything. He's already done it all. He died on the cross to pay for everything. And he rose from the dead, conquering sin and death. If today's the day for you, I'm going to pray a prayer. And maybe just this will help you to kind of solidify this in your own heart, to put to words what you're thinking and feeling right now. It's not a magic prayer. It's not the words that save you. It's Jesus and his grace that save you. And I'll pray this, and if you want to pray it along with me, you can, just right where you're at. And simply this, dear God, I admit that I need you. And I believe you love me, Jesus. You died on the cross to save me. You did what I couldn't do for myself. Come into my life and save me. I put my faith and trust in you alone. I put my life forever in your hands. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me and saving me. Amen. Amen. In just a moment, our ushers are going to come around. They're going to receive those Connect cards if you filled one of those out. If you didn't fill one of those out, I encourage you to do so. And if today's the day we're at Collect, you're like, I put my faith and trust in Jesus. I'm being straight with you. As a kid, I prayed a prayer. I thought I was a Christian. I wasn't sure. I went to church, but there was a day where it hit, where it clicked, where I put my faith and trust in Jesus, and he became real. And no longer was it me trying to go through life hanging on to an inner tube and like, well, I said some prayer one time, but I put my trust in Jesus, and it changed. It was not without effect, let me tell you. And if that's your story today, if you put your trust in Jesus, can you just mark it on that Connect card? We just want to celebrate it with you. We'll not embarrass you at all, promise. The ushers are going to come around. They'll receive those Connect cards. They'll also, at this time, for those of us that call Grace City home, this is our opportunity to give. And thank you so much for your continued generosity. I'm completely blown away by the generosity of this church family. I think, as I mentioned earlier, but our Easter offering this year, this offering this morning is going to go to help send students to Passion Camp this summer, to students from our church, from our community. Some of them you may never even meet. They're kids from the community that come out on Wednesday nights and have been hearing about Jesus. And this is going to help send them to Passion Camp this summer, where they'll hear teaching and spend time in worship all week. So if you would like, this as our opportunity to give. And I would encourage you, if you want to stand and join, let's sing, let's worship, let's celebrate the fact that he has given us new life. Will you stand and join me? Let's worship.
Anything that he wants to.
was cast and men was thrown on the bones of Elijah. If there's anything that he can't do, just ask the stone. Open the grave, I'm coming out, I'm gonna live and live again. Open the grave, I'm coming out, I'm gonna live and live again. Open the grave, I'm coming out, I'm gonna live and live again. This is the sound of Jabba's Adelaide.
Much for being with us this morning. Thanks for choosing to spend this time with us. As you go, I want to encourage you. I really want to challenge you over these next couple of weeks. The tomb is empty today. The tomb will also be empty tomorrow. The tomb will also be empty next Sunday. And I want to encourage you, we'll be back next Sunday, not only for our Spring Fling, it's Commitment Sunday, but we're also kicking off a new series next week. And we're going to spend the next 6 weeks. Here's my goal is for Jesus and the way he loves us just to totally blow your mind. We're going to kick off a new series called Watch Me. And it's simply you had a little insert in your worship guide as you came in. We're going to look at these stories of the way Jesus loved people and how he taught us to love each other. Our whole heart here as a church is to love like Jesus. And how did Jesus love people in these different situations? And what does that mean for us? And how can we follow him in that? So don't miss out on that, please. As you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he shine on you. May you remember that the tomb is empty, that he is alive. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Love you guys. Go in peace.
What a powerful message. We hope that it impacted you in a life-changing way. In the meantime, you can go online at wearegrace.city and learn more about the church, next steps from baptism to Bibles. And we would love for you to join us here in person anytime on Sundays at 9:30 a.m. and 11 a.m. In the meantime, we hope that you continue to be the church right where you are with what you have right now. We'll see you next time.